In this video, we're gonna take a look at Procreate Dreams and get started animating with this new tool from Procreate. When you first open up Dreams, you're gonna see a similar UI than you have in Procreate. So to create a new animation, all you have to do is press this plus button and you will be presented with these options where you can see some preset canvas sizes that are usually used in animation. So here you will see your vertical and landscape modes, and I'm gonna create a vertical animation. As a quick disclaimer, I think it's important to emphasize that this is a beta version of Procreate Dreams, and some things can change between what I see on my screen right now and the release. So let's just remember that I am not a developer of this program, I'm just an artist, and let's be grateful for Savage for letting us use this new tool. At first, the interface might be a little bit intimidating, but I'm hoping that this video will unlock those basic features that will get you started as quickly as possible and get you making your first animation. As inspiration, I recommend looking at the project files that are already within Dreams, where you can see how different artists have created their own animations. If you're an illustrator or a concept artist like me, then this button right here might be completely new to you. This is a switch between timeline edit and content mode. Timeline is like normal timeline for video editing, as you see in After Effects or Premiere Pro, for example. But in content mode, let's go into content mode. You can go in to the specific stuff that is on that frame. Like for example, here we have this one frame animation, and here we can make individual adjustments to that specific frame. Or we can go into drawing mode in content mode and then just draw on that individual frame. And if we move between frames, you can see that we can move between these different items of content. Just like in Procreate, you can undo with two fingers and go forwards with three fingers. So if you've been using Procreate up to this point, a lot of these touch controls are going to feel immediately intuitive to you. Just like in Procreate, these sliders control the opacity of your brush and the size of your brush. So basically, when you're in drawing mode, you don't need to learn anything new. It works just the same way as Procreate itself. When you look at this user interface, there are a few important buttons that might not be immediately obvious to you. If you look at here, where it says Dream 6, this is actually one of the most important buttons in Procreate Dreams. And if we tap this, we can see all of our project settings in this one screen. You can adjust, for example, your timeline length, your timeline type, you can make a looping animation, and you can export your animation from here. You can also change the canvas size of your animation right here by inputting new parameters into these text boxes. If you're used to traditional editing programs, there is no out point that you can adjust on the timeline. However, here in properties, you can set the duration of your animation, and that is performing the same function. For example, if you already know that your animation is going to be 15 seconds long, you can simply input 15 seconds here, and that automatically adjusts the length of your animation. In export settings, you can set the format of your exported video and the quality of your video. For example, here, by tapping the video, you can set one of the three different quality settings, and in custom settings, you can set the file format. If like me, you end up doing some video editing later with your content, I recommend going into custom settings right here and then setting your file container to MP4, honestly, because it's just a more flexible file format. And as a PC user, it's a lot easier for me to use in Premiere, for example. If you're doing your animation file in a huge size, one way to avoid clutter is to go into Rescale. Here it says Document Size. And here you can set the export settings so that you can export your file into smaller sizes than your canvas size already is. So you can have your work area in a different size and then output in a smaller size, For example, if you're outputting video for TikTok, there's no point in making an 8K video for that. Now that we are in content mode where we can edit individual content by grabbing and moving it around, I want to show one more difference between this and timeline edit. So if I'm in timeline and I have a huge amount of different content, and let's say that I, for example, wanted to get rid of all of these top layers, in timeline edit mode, you can make really fast selections by simply selecting them all with your stylus. However, when you are in content mode, you are moving the entire timeline by grabbing it like this. So the way to move in timeline and to move the playhead in content mode is by either tapping on the timeline that you see here, and you can see that the playhead, that is this icon right here, it moves to wherever I'm tapping the screen. Or I can grab this and move it all around. I don't have any animation here, so that's why you don't see anything moving yet. But this is one way to test, for example, one area of animation. One more thing about the timeline, that it is zoom specific. So if, for example, I am zoomed really close in right here and I press play, you can see that the timeline is repeating just these 2 seconds where I'm zoomed in. But if I zoom out, it is timeline specific, so it's going to play the entire thing that is visible to it. And this can be a very intuitive, fast way to edit one small part of your animation. On the left side of the screen, you can see that there are these checkboxes where you can turn on and off the visibility of your layers. But instead of scrolling all the way here into the beginning of our animation, you can see that they dynamically appear always on the left side of the screen, no matter where on your timeline you are zooming in. So you can always access that and isolate the layer that you are working on. Now, when I have this layer isolated, I can go into the drawing mode by pressing this icon and then just draw whatever I want on this layer. When I'm on this piece of content, I'm just gonna make a new layer and you're gonna see what I'm gonna do with this later. So I'm color picking one color from here, just like in Procreate. And then on this layer, I am tapping a new dot to create a new planet. It's a bit of a wobbly planet, but anyway, it's there. And now you can see that this piece of content is one single cluster. Once I long press this layer, I get this menu where I can select convert layers to tracks. And now you can see that this layer has turned into a group. And in this group, if I press this button, you can see that 2 different layers are individually selectable. If I press this playhead, I can move this element individually. So I am moving it from its original position into here. And once I zoom out, you will see that I have automatically created 2 different keyframes. One is in the beginning of the animation, right here, and one at the point where I moved it, right here. And this keyframe can also be moved around by grabbing it and moving it on your timeline. On top of that, you can also adjust the easy ease and easy out features of this keyframe. So I'm gonna go into the beginning of this animation and long press this keyframe and then expand transform. And here you can see the different values of X, Y, and different scaling options that I have for this keyframe. I'm gonna press the X and Y and set easing ease out. Do the same for this location as well. Ease out. This makes the easing happen smoothly at the beginning of the animation until the animation ends. Now let's see how that looks. So this kind of movement you can already do with just keyframes without doing any frame by frame animation. So this is something that anybody can do, whether you're an animator or not. Now let's make these planets rotate during this animation. So I'm gonna tap on this playhead, then select move, and then move and scale. And move and scale also means rotate after I tap the red dot. And then I'm just gonna move this whole planetary system, like a whole 360 degrees. Now, I have created a keyframe for this rotation as well. And the starting keyframe has automatically been created here in the beginning of the animation, so we can see how that looks when we play the animation. On top of these features, you also have a performance mode that is honestly even more easy to use than these, because you can just move the element by hand and perform the action that you want the layer to create. I have these two different planets here selected right now, and I'm gonna go into performance mode and I'm gonna select a length of time that is the same as the animation itself. Okay, now I'm going to press the record button, which is going to start the performance mode. And only when I start moving this element, it's going to start recording for that timeline. So I want this element to move along this solar system while it's doing the rotation. So I'm going to grab it and then just move it. And now when I'm done with my animation, I can just press stop. And here I have created keyframes for this whole thing. And now when we play back this animation, we can see that the rotation is happening even though the location is changing based on my hand movements on screen. So with these small movements, we already have a whole solar system that is moving. Now you might see that there is an error in layer order right here, and you can move different pieces of content around completely freely and just sort out your entire animation on your content timeline itself. And these work just the same way as layers. I'm going to drag this and then just drag it down here. And now when those planets move behind this smiley looking Earth, you can see that the content is in the right order. You can also change the blend mode directly from this menu. So all you have to do is long press your content, and here you can see the same different blend modes that you have in Procreate as well. One more thing about keyframes that I want to show that is really cool. Once you press the playhead and go into edit, you can also keyframe all of these different effects, like for example Gaussian blur. Here, if I set a Gaussian blur amount for this layer, now if I zoom in and press play, you can see that that Gaussian blur gets animated throughout this timeline. But if I just want to have a static effect applied to the layer, I can simply delete the beginning keyframe, and then there is no movement between different keyframes. So now that glow is static, just the way that I set it in Gaussian blur. One more thing that is super cool about these keyframes is that if you press the playhead, select move, you can also select warp as your animation style. So here you can have all of the warp controls, and this can be one way for you to animate really cool looking, very organic movement. And this is all keyframed based on what your first frame is and where you're setting it to. By combining this with the other animation tools, you can create some really cool looking lighting effects. On top of images, you can use this plus icon to also import entire videos into your timeline. Just remember that you need to have content on top of that video track if you want to make additions like these to your video. You cannot draw directly on your video file, you have to draw on a layer above it. Honestly, it's embarrassing to admit, but it took me way too long to find how to do frame-by-frame animation in Dreams, and to avoid any frustration on your part, I'm gonna show you how to do that right now. So I'm gonna add more effects to this bark part, just to emphasize how loud Vivi is when she's barking before starting this little song. So in here, I'm gonna create a new content track. And you have to be in content mode here, not in timeline edit, but in content mode when you want to do frame by frame animation. And on this layer that I have chosen right here, I'm gonna create a new drawing. So I'm gonna go into the drawing mode, and here you can see a very low contrast line right here. I'm gonna drag it down. And now I'm in Flipbook, where I can draw individual frames, and these are individual frames of my animation. And all of these frames are happening on that layer that I chose earlier. And if you want to go out of this mode, you simply need to press this small X button. And to go back, you can just drag this down. So I'm gonna create more effects for this bark face by drawing here, like a small circle. It's basically like a special effect that I'm doing here. So you can see that the previous frame is now highlighted in green. So I can reference that when I'm doing my edits. But these are quite close in color and it's kind of hard to tell apart. So you can change that by going and pressing the time of your animation and then edit on your skin. Here, the backwards animation colors are chosen to be green. So I'm gonna choose them to be red. It's really clear to see. And if I want to have forwards frames, I don't have any at this point, but if I want to have them, I'm gonna choose orange for those. So here, this has changed now to orange because it's in the future. Now this is in the past, so it's red. Let's create a few more frames really quickly so that I can show how this works. Honestly, I'm not an animator, but this is kind of fun. It's so easy to add little effects like these. These sort of effects are a perfect place to start. Especially if you have a video file that you can draw on, then you have the whole timing kind of figured out for you. When I was doing these other frames, for example, I was constantly referencing the placement of Vivi's head so that you can see that these lines are following that. That way, it took a lot of the planning from the whole process and I could just focus on making it look as fun as possible. This is only a small portion of this workflow, but I got really addicted to this yesterday and I ended up working on this way longer than I have any time for. And here you can see the entire power of the bark happening. Every one of these frames is an individual piece of content, and that makes them kind of hard to edit. So that's why the timeline selection mode is super handy to select all of these at once, and I can group these. And now when they are grouped, I'm just gonna long press it and then press copy. I'm gonna go into content mode. I'm gonna create a new content track. And on this content track, I'm gonna hit paste. I'm just dragging this exactly on top of that previous frame. And the reason is because I want to add a small blur to this one. So I'm gonna go into filter, Gaussian blur, and blur it a little bit. You can see that it looks kind of ugly right now, but I'm gonna change the blend mode into additive. So this is making the whole ring kind of glow the same way that the rest of the elements are glowing. And that's how I created this glow, so that I didn't have to draw everything twice. I just grouped them, copied them, and then added a blur to them. And honestly, you can do something way more meaningful than visualize a subwoofer like this, but I think this was just super addicting to work on, and if I'm not careful, I'm gonna waste more time doing this. With these techniques, you should already have enough information to start your first animations in Procreate Dreams. Here, I'm just scratching the surface of what you can do with this application, and I'm sure I'm gonna keep learning new things and creating new, more in-depth tutorials on how to use Procreate Dreams and create your own animations. So if you want to see those, remember to subscribe, and I'll see you guys in the next video.